He just keeps going. How could I not? The first creative strategy for 6.0 goes old school, back to season 7, Survivor Pearl Islands, and it's an example of utilizing anything you have in your repertoire to get ahead. I've been wanting to mention this one since like 2.0, so here we go. Pearl Islands, episode 13, The Final Five. In a challenge called Corks and Keys, the players have to use a small canteen to collect some water and then deposit the water into a thin tube. As the tube fills with water, a float with a key attached will slowly surface. When it's high enough, you grab the key, unlock your next plank, and you keep going. You have to repeat this process 5 times, releasing 5 planks to grab a flag at the end of the course and get back to the finish. And the first player back to the finish with their flag wins. It needs to be said, you can only refill your canteen at the starting plank, meaning you have to tread more ground the further you make it into the challenge. Dara's creative strategy to win this challenge proves to be very efficient. It's also a simple maneuver, as they tend to be in this video series. The tubes with the keys are thin and long, so it looks like you're gonna need to do several trips to fill it up with a bunch of water so that you can actually reach the key. Well, after just one trip, one dumping the water from her canteen into the tube, Dara forced her hand, her wrist, and the length of her arm all the way to the bottom of the tube, grabbed her key, and kept going. This saved her a ton of time, as she only needed to make 5 trips total, one for each tube, to win the challenge. I give Dara credit here because it doesn't seem likely the producers intended for the challenge to be so simple. Likewise, we later saw that both Johnny Fairplay and Lil could pull off the same technique to get their key, only needing one trip, but it was Dara who pushed on and forced her hand into the tube despite it not being all that comfortable, before anyone else bothered to go the extra mile. Dara did it first, nabbed a lead, and proved to the others that it was possible winning the challenge because of it. Also, props to Burton for attempting to use his canteen to fish out a key. Had it worked, you probably would be seeing it on this list. Going even further old school for this next one, and it is probably one of my favorites, just for how simple of a unique strategy it is. Seriously, this is gonna be really, really simple. In episode 5 of season 3, Survivor Africa, we saw 2 tribes compete in a reward challenge for a bunch of chickens. The challenge itself wasn't that complicated. Each tribe had a herd or tribe or trip of goats. Apparently groups of goats can be called many things, so I will be saying each tribe had a tribe of goats that they had to herd or trip from one pen to another. There were 40 goats in total, and each tribe had 20 designated goats. As you could imagine, the difficulty with this challenge was simply getting the goats to do what you wanted them to do. Your tribe had to lead them in the right direction while also avoiding your opponent's players, who were sometimes getting in the way, blocking you off, or distracting your goats from going in the right direction. After a short period of time, Silas and Clarence from the Yellow Baran tribe realized these goats aren't that big. There's no rule against taking matters into our own hands. So instead of herding the goats, they just picked them up and carried them to the designated pen. They also then got Ethan and Frank, 2 of their other tribe members, to follow suit, and this proved to be a great strategy. The Red tribe, on the other hand, took a long time to attempt this, instead opting to herd the goats the usual way, just yelling at them and smacking a twig on the ground. Amusingly, Big Tom, who was on the Red tribe, the losing tribe, was a goat farmer, and he lost the challenge involving goats. You guys know what they say, rule number 56 of reality television: if a challenge fits your profession, you're probably not gonna win it.
Got 40 goats in there, they've been marked. 20 with Samburo colors, 20 with Baran colors. First tribe to get their 20 goats into their own pen at the finish line wins the reward. What do you got, Teresa? Baran wins.
You know what? Speaking of Big Tom, despite not winning that goat challenge, let's give him some credit for what he pulls off in episode 14 of season 8, Survivor All-Stars, where he goes on to use a small, subtle technique that keeps his chances of winning this challenge alive and ultimately nets him the immunity necklace. For this challenge, the players have two buckets on either end of a seesaw, and they need to create a fire in one bucket and then fill up the second bucket with water. When the second bucket is full of water, it'll raise the fire bucket in the air and light the fuse. First player to light their fuse wins. Each player is given an armful of kindling and a box of matches to create their fire, but it's important to note that if a player runs out of matches, they automatically lose the challenge. Likewise, the water bucket has a hole in its side which slowly drains the water from it, meaning you need to constantly run back and forth refilling your bucket of water to lift your fire bucket higher. But you also need to tend to your fire bucket to ensure the fire is staying alive, otherwise you end up with what happens to Boston Rob. He gets a small fire going, fills up his water bucket really quickly, but then the fire isn't strong enough to light the fuse when it gets to the top. He then has to wait for his water bucket to empty, and by the time his fire gets back to him on the ground, it's practically dead. That's the key to this challenge. Don't get eager and assume your fire will stay alive while you work on the water bucket. There's only so many matches and so much kindling you're given, so don't waste it. And that's what Big Tom ensures he doesn't do. Whereas we saw Rob, Amber, Jenna, and Rupert all create weak fires and eventually run out of matches, Tom keeps his fire alive by doing one little thing differently. He takes some of his kindling and sticks and rests them on top of his bucket, which meant that while he made the necessary 4 or 5 trips to fill up the water bucket, his fire was guaranteed to stay high enough and alive enough, that's the most important part, to not die on him while he tended to getting that fire in the air. This proved to easily be the most effective strategy, and I think it more than made up for him losing that goat challenge.
Moat. Boston Rob is out of matches, has no fire, out of the competition. Amber's out of matches. Boston Rob and Amber, out of the competition. Rupert's out of matches. Rupert out of the competition. Down to Big Tom and Sheehan, and Big Tom has a fire going.
I'm out of patience.
Tom really doing a good job with the fire right now.
Great.
Patience is paying
good,
off.
Nice. Go
not quite enough.
Tom,
this could be enough.
One.
That's it. Wins immunity!
Now brace yourselves, guys, because what I'm about to say might blow some people's minds. The fourth unique tactic is from an international season of Survivor, which, I know, is a whole nother can of worms we're opening. It's from Australian Survivor, and if you haven't seen the season, I will pretty much be keeping this spoilers incredibly light. But if you're a fan of the American version, I'd highly recommend checking out the show if you can find a way to watch it somewhere online. In episode 13 of Australian Survivor All-Stars, we see two tribes compete in a challenge that is reminiscent of an American Survivor challenge. It's a challenge called a Bit Tipsy, and it involves players balancing blocks on a wobbly base held up by a rope, where the players must slowly move back and forth, balancing their base with the blocks while stacking them. The first tribe to have every member successfully stack their 3 blocks wins. We've seen this challenge a lot on modern American Survivor, starting with season 27, Blood vs. Water, and ending with season 40, Winners at War. I actually covered a version of it in Challenge Hacks 1.0 in this video series with a tribe dynamic, and I did go back and do my homework. I checked each American season to see if any player pulls off this little technique in the Australian version, and nobody does. And I'm not sure if that's because there's like a rule set in place to prevent them from doing so, or in some cases because the challenge was tweaked and they just straight up couldn't. But either way, it's unique to this season of Australian Survivor, so let's give it a nod. As I was saying, the players here had to balance 3 blocks on top of each other, but the blocks were lightweight. I think lighter than any other iteration of this challenge, and it proved to be a constant pain as nobody could manage to balance them. After so many times having their blocks fall, a player named Harry decided to change one thing ever so slightly that proved to have a huge difference. Because the blocks were tall and kept falling forward or backward, he realized giving them more support in the direction they were falling would make them more stable. So he rotated his blocks 45 degrees, allowing the corner to serve as support for when the base leaned in either direction. This made the challenge a fair bit easier for him, and he was able to make his way to the finish line, having stacked 3 blocks successfully a lot quicker. His tribe mates AK and Shawnee also followed suit right after, finding success with this strategy as well, which led to his tribe winning immunity. We even went on to see a few members of the other tribe attempt to copy them, although they lacked patience, something you really need with this challenge, and thus were kind of screwed no matter what. The smallest of tweaks can make a huge difference.
Okay.
Let's
Barry placing his third block. AK places his second. Shawnee dumps her entire stack. She's gonna have to start over. That's it. Harry's good. He's back behind the start line. Now it's up to Shawnee.
Just do you, Sean.
Shawnee placing the final block for Vakama. Can she get it to stick? Her stack is looking good. Now she needs to get back to the start line. Shawnee, one more inch and that's it.
For the last creative strategy, let's bring it back to a player featured in a previous video in this series and talk all about Adam Klein from season 33, Survivor Millennials versus Generation X. In every case highlighted in this series for all six parts thus far, we have focused on players using strategies to win challenges, but what if we shift our perspective a bit and talk about defensive strategies not so much to win a challenge, but instead to guarantee other players don't? In Adam's case, in the bigger picture, his winning endgame strategy was to have a herd of bigger threats to ensure there was always someone ahead of him to be voted out in the pecking order. By the final seven, there were several threats left, particularly Jay and David, and in the episode 12 immunity challenge, Adam focused less on having himself win it and more on ensuring anyone but those two players won. After all, I'm not sure if you heard, but Jay did have an immunity idol, and Adam did one at Flushed.
Jay does have an idol.
Jay does have an idol.
Does have an idol.
Jay does have an idol.
Jay has an idol.
We know Jay has an idol.
I can confirm Jay has an idol.
Jay does have an idol.
Jay has an idol.
So Jay has an idol.
This challenge was called Pinball Wizard, a reference to The Who, and it involved dividing your attention between rolling a ball down a pachinko contraption while also assembling a 25-piece puzzle. So long as your ball was headed down the slope, you could work on the puzzle, but if you didn't catch the ball before it hit the bottom in the gutter, you would have to wait for the ball to go down a series of long slopes or gutters, which took a lot of time away from finishing your puzzle. When you're so focused on your puzzle, sometimes you slip up for just a second and it costs you dearly. Midway through the challenge, Adam realized that he likely wasn't going to win this, but there was a chance either Jay or David could. So instead, what Adam did here was abandon his puzzle and focus solely on helping his ally Ken stay alert on the location of his ball. When Ken's ball was close to the gutter, Adam would alert Ken to go back and save it. This allowed Ken to save time and be more efficient with putting his puzzle together, and really, it removed half the difficulty of the challenge simply by teaming up. And yeah, this defensive strategy worked. Jay didn't win, and his idol was flushed later that night, and that was the main point of the strategy.
Ken, I'm gonna tell you when your ball is dropping. Keep working.
Ken is still wrong. Ken gonna try again to change it.
Ken, come back. Ken, come back. Ken, come back.
Whoa, nice hit by Ken.
Really, Adam?
Ken wins individual immunity. Safe from the vote.
And then let's fast forward to the final four immunity challenge of the same season, Millennials Gen X, with Adam, Ken, David, and Hannah. Using the same mantra as the previous example that we just talked about, Adam didn't want David to win immunity, so he pulls off a subtle technique that practically guarantees David won't win it. For this challenge, players had to navigate bowls through a maze and then balance them at the top of a wobbly pedestal. The first player to balance all 13 bowls, or the player who had the most bowls in place after 30 minutes, would be the winner. Because there was a lot of wind, the bowls easily fell, especially the higher you stacked them, costing a lot of time. And Adam took note of this, and again, played defensively. Not to ensure that he would win immunity, but to ensure his target wouldn't. Several times throughout the challenge, Adam would have the lead, and then stop competing. He would have 10 bowls, or 8 bowls, and then stop. He'd just stand there. He could have kept stacking to get to 13, but that would increase the risk of the wind knocking them over, putting David ahead of him. So he waited for David, who was behind him, to potentially catch up. At one point, both Hannah and Ken were ahead of Adam with 10 bowls each, but Adam still did nothing even though he only had 8. And that was all because David only had 7. Until David caught up, Adam didn't need to make an unforced error. By the end of the 30 minutes, both Ken and Hannah had 10 bowls each, Adam still had 8, and at that point, it didn't matter who won between Ken or Hannah in the tiebreaker. David didn't have enough to even stack up to Adam's 8, so he therefore wasn't going to win. David was the bigger threat, and because of Adam's defensive technique, he was eligible to be voted out. And to Adam, in all likelihood, he just won the season.
Ken is going for number 12 while Adam just watching. Adam now stepping off his platform. Adam's strategy worked. David now working on his sixth, and Adam is sitting on eight. Adam just watching, once again, taking the defensive position in this game to let somebody else mess up. Adam will only win if both Hannah and Ken drop. That is it. We are tied 10-10. We will have a showdown between Hannah and Ken.
I'm sorry that I was rooting against you so hard at the immunity challenge, but I basically gave up my shot at immunity just to make sure that you didn't win. If they don't vote you out, I lose the game. So what does it matter?
And with that, Challenge Hack 6.0 is in the algorithm. I mean, in the books. It's in the books. Can't wait for Hacks 29.0 in the distant future when we feature a season of everyone who has ever hacked a challenge in Survivor. But yeah, I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Is there a 7.0 out there? Let me know if you have any potential creative strategic examples to talk about that you want me to talk about in the future, but otherwise, a huge thank you to my patrons for putting up with me for this long. Don't forget, on your way out, to forget about all these strategies next time we see each other on the beaches of Fiji, and I will see you in the next one once I pitch a new season idea. Jeff, hear me out. Survivor, hackers versus slackers versus hustlers.
Big scramble for the ball, Cook still has it.